Welcome back to my channel and welcome back to True Crime and Wine. I hope you have your wine glasses ready, your throw blankets wrapped around you, socks, fuzzy socks on, blunts rolled, lights on or off, depending on how you like to watch your true crime shit. And you're ready for this really disturbing, fucked up story. I got an email from C. Salisbury 714. They didn't have a name on their email, it's literally just what it says, and they requested that I do the Shonda Scherer case. And before I continue to tell this story, I must say that it is probably one of the most disturbing cases that I've done research on thus far. I mean, all of them are quite disturbing, but this one is very gnarly, pretty graphic, and it's done to a minor. So if that's not something that you want to sit through, if that's not something you want to listen to, I'm just putting this disclaimer at the front that this is done to a 12-year-old girl. The details are really disturbing, and I don't want you to be upset if you get halfway through this video and you're shooketh at all the facts that are compiled in this case. So this is just a warning. This is about a 12-year-old girl who was brutally tortured and brutally murdered after being kidnapped. So if that is not something you want to listen to, this is not the true crime for you. It was requested. The first request I got was from C. Salisbury 714, so thank you for that. I'm sure a few other people sent emails about it because I actually had that on the list like 3 or 4 times. And at the beginning when I was getting submission emails, I wasn't writing down who was requesting it, but now I am. So anytime you send me recommendations on reaction videos or true crime stories to do, I will be shouting you out at the beginning of the video. So I appreciate anyone taking their time out who watch my true crime videos, enjoy my true crime videos, and also send me stories they want me to retell. This story has been requested by C. Salisbury 714. Thank you for watching my true crime and thank you for the submission. This story is about to begin and it's really, 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 really fucked up. Shonda Scherer was born on June 6, 1979 in Pineville, Kentucky. Her father was Stephen Scherer and her mother was Jacqueline Vaught. I think I'm saying that correct. Jackie had been married before and then she met Stephen and got remarried and then they had Shonda. However, when Shonda was still young, her parents, Stephen and Jacqueline, didn't work out. They ended up getting divorced and Jackie actually took Shonda with her to Louisville, Kentucky. And there she was eventually remarried. Shonda was described as a very bubbly, active, friendly girl. She was also very good at school. She got really good grades. She played sports. She was a cheerleader. She was on the volleyball team. She did gymnastics. She played basketball. You name it, she was probably doing it. She was very active. She loved to make new friends. Her personality was definitely that of an extrovert. In June of 1991, Shonda's mother, Jackie, got divorced again with her stepfather. Her and the stepdad did not work out. And around Shonda's 12th birthday, Jackie moved her and Shonda to New Albany, Indiana, so that she could be closer to her dad and see him more often. Obviously, any kid that gets pulled out of whatever school they're at and moves to a new school is gonna have anxiety, is gonna be pissed at their parents, and it's just going to be difficult. When Gabby and I grew up, we were in North Andover, and at some point they pulled us out of North Andover and they put us in Tewksbury, and they pulled us out of Tewksbury and they brought us to Methuen. And so not once but twice we had to do changes after we had to get comfortable adjusting to what was already new. So when we left North Andover, we had to adjust to Tewksbury, and then when we finally adjusted to Tewksbury, we had to get comfortable in Methuen. And I'm not gonna lie, it does cause some issues, it does cause some fights. You do start battling with your parents, you blame them from separating from your quote-unquote best friends, taking away from what could be amazing childhood memories, and you resent them. And as parents, you don't know what to do, because obviously your life needs to keep moving and your children need to move with you. So obviously at some point Shonda and Jackie probably butted heads over the move. Shonda was upset, she wasn't happy, so on and so forth. But with that being said, there they are in New Albany, Indiana, starting over. Jackie enrolled Shonda into Hazelwood Middle School. Because of her bubbly, outgoing personality, it was not difficult for Shonda to just hit the pavement and start immediately making friends. So she's coming home from school and she's happy, she's excited, she actually likes her new middle school. So her mother's like, oh, thank God, like, this is great. Like, all this stress, all this anxiety, all this bullshit, at least my daughter is adjusting well to her new school. However, a couple days later, this girl that Shonda was trying to be friends with was explaining to Shonda that her boyfriend and her broke up and she wanted to give the ring that he gave her back, but she didn't want to do it. And Shonda, being that person that wanted to prove that she was a good friend, especially since she's in this new school with new people, she volunteered as tribute to give the ring back to her ex-boyfriend. Obviously, the girl was like, okay, cool, yeah, you can do that. So she goes up to this guy and she's trying to give him the ring back, and he starts freaking out. He's like, I don't want it back. If she wants to give me something back, she can give it to me herself. Now, I'm trying to think back to when I was 12, and I don't remember there being drama like rings and shit going down. I think like the biggest deal was if you got asked to dance at school dances. Like, I don't think anyone was giving each other rings or screaming in the hallways about breakups. Maybe I'm incorrect, but I don't think that's how my life was when I was 12. But they seem to have a lot of middle school drama going on. So while all this is happening, Shonda's just like, please just take the ring. Like, she wants to give it back to you. Just take it, please. I'm begging you. Like, I don't want to go back to this girl. Like, I failed. Like, I can't be a good friend to her. Just please take the ring. And in the process of all this, his cousin, who is 14 years old, female, comes over and shoves Shonda. This female, her name was Amanda Heaverin. I'm sorry if I'm saying that incorrectly, but I think for once I'm saying it correctly. She comes over and she shoves Shonda, and Shonda's like, what the hell? This girl has been known to get into fights at school. Amanda's a tomboy, she's rough, she's also 2 years older than Shonda. She's 14, Shonda's 12. So they get into an actual fist fight. Shonda has never been in trouble before. This is a girl that gets good grades. She does pretty much every extracurricular activity, and now she's in the hallway of her new school trying to make new friends, fist fighting this dude's cousin. So she goes home and she's got a bump on her head, a cut on her face, and her mom's like, what the hell? She gets a phone call from the principal explaining what's going on, and she's like, 2 days ago it was all good. 2 days ago it was all good. You were happy, you were making friends. Now all of a sudden the principal's calling saying you're getting into fist fights in school. This is insanity. Shonda and Amanda both got a week's worth of detention. Now, you would think in detention these girls would argue some more, realize they hate each other, but this week's worth of detention actually made these two girls resolve their issues and become friends. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm probably never gonna be friends with someone who put hands on me. All right, we might be acquaintances, you know, we might say hey to each other in the hallway, but I'm not going, if someone didn't know me and was cool putting hands on me, what's gonna happen if I'm friends with her and we have a falling out? But again, Shonda's 12 years old. Like, at 12 years old, do we even really know shit? Especially if Shonda's always been a good girl, always has gotten good grades, and has always had friends. She doesn't really know what it's like to get in trouble, not have friends, or be around people that aren't good people to be around. So kinda at 12 years old, you don't know what's best for you. 14, you're kind of more getting into who you're probably gonna be in the future, but also 14 is super young. Like, I think about what I was doing at 14, and I wasn't making making that good of decisions, and I also didn't really know shit either. So whatever the case may be, they become friends, and the age gap I think is a little alarming. I don't think I was friends, I guess maybe not. In middle school I was friends with people that were older, I guess. Now you have Shonda's mother Jackie at home, who obviously doesn't like Amanda because Amanda is the person that fist bought her daughter in the hallway and landed her daughter in detention for a week when her daughter has never been in detention. When she finds out that Shonda and Amanda are actually friends and are hanging out outside of school, Jackie is upset, as any mom would. You could already tell that this woman might not be a good influence on your daughter, so that would be upsetting. Any mom, any good mom would be upset about that. Obviously, Jackie explains to her daughter her concerns, and Shonda defends Amanda. She's like, no, it wasn't her fault. She's a good person, yada, 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 yada. So reluctantly, Jackie has no choice to just be quiet. If Amanda and a friendship with Amanda is gonna make her daughter happy, then she's just going to allow it. However, in the process of hanging out with Amanda, Jackie noticed that her daughter is starting to change. She starts getting into trouble. Her grades are slipping. The good girl that once was is changing right before her eyes. And the only person Jackie has to blame is Amanda. As Shonda's relationship with Amanda grew, they obviously started learning more about each other. And in the process, Shonda learned that Amanda had a romantic on-again, off-again relationship with a 16-year-old girl named Melinda Lovelace. The last name is very fitting for this See You Next Tuesday, as she turns out to be the devil in this story. But we'll get to that later. Melinda is 2 years older than Amanda and 4 years older than Shonda. Amanda and Melinda's relationship was very toxic. They would fight, they would break up, they would get back together. They would fight, they would break up, they would get back together. Now, when Amanda started becoming friends with Shonda, her and Melinda were not together. They were broken up. So Melinda Lovelace came from a very abusive home. Her parents were Marjorie and Larry Lovelace. Marjorie and Larry had a very toxic relationship. Melinda witnessed her father, Larry, rape and sexually abuse their mother, but he also sexually abused Melinda, her sisters, and her cousins. He was a very, 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 very bad dude. Melinda's mother, Marjorie, said that Larry molested all of her children, every single one of them. She also said that Larry stayed and slept in the same bed as Melinda until she was 14 years old. Now, Melinda will later claim that yes, he did in fact sleep in the bed with her until she was 14 years old, but he did not have sex with her. I don't think that's true. She might be in denial. I've watched a lot of Law & Order SVU, and I feel like a lot of victims try to block out certain memories because it's so traumatic for them. But again, maybe he did sleep in the bed with her and didn't touch her. But first of all, it's completely inappropriate and not okay for a grown man, let alone a father, to sleep in the same bed as his daughter at any given time. Unless she's like obviously like an infant and you're taking care of the infant. But when she's at the age where she's starting to develop and get her period and learn about her body and becoming a woman, anything about a father sleeping in the same bed as his daughter is disturbing. Disturbing. Marjorie, Melinda's mother, also claimed that one time she had caught Larry creeping, looking into Melinda's bedroom while Melinda was with one of her friends changing, and she stabbed him with a knife. He ended up being hospitalized, she ended up getting arrested, and after his hospitalization, he left her, divorced her, moved to Florida, and got remarried and had other children in his new marriage. Barely kept in touch with Melinda and his other daughters. Every once in a while, he'd send them a letter or two. But other than that, barely any communication. And Melinda felt abandoned by her abuser slash her father. Now, it's said online that Melinda had mental problems. I couldn't find the extent of her mental problems. I couldn't find what she was diagnosed with. I don't know if she was in mental facilities. I don't know if she was on medication. I couldn't dive deep into any of her history or her medical records. I have no idea if in fact she did have mental illness. I don't know if she was on medication. I don't have a clue, but it's said that she did have mental illness. I'm gonna go ahead and say I believe it, because any girl who gets sexually abused by her dad and has her father sleeping in the bed with her until she's 14 to eventually abandon her to have a brand new life with a brand new family with other daughters he's probably molesting, that definitely warrants warrants someone having issues. Trauma that no 14-year-old probably understands. And I couldn't find online if she was in a facility getting help for her issues. And if she wasn't getting help with her issues and understanding and dealing with her trauma, that's just gonna build up. And a 14-year-old is not gonna know what to do with all that trauma and all that buildup. It's just impossible. So this happened when she was 14. Now Melinda's 16, but for years she's dealing with this trauma and understanding this trauma. And Amanda is 14. She meets Melinda. Melinda has some issues going on, and those issues are going to go into any relationship Melinda probably has. So cues Amanda meeting Melinda. They start this relationship, and it's already toxic because Melinda only knows toxicity. And so they're on again, they're off again, they're on again and off again. And Amanda's only 14. She doesn't know what a real relationship is. I don't know what her parents taught her. I don't know what she knows about relationships, but at 14, we don't know shit. So she's in this relationship with this 16-year-old older woman, and it's nothing but toxicity. So now Amanda also only knows toxicity, and it's just overall not healthy. When Melinda first told her mother, Marjorie, that she was gay, her mother refused to accept it. She verbally abused Melinda, called her names, and just was completely against her daughter being with another woman. Eventually, Melinda's mother was like, it. You know, if you're a lesbian, you're a lesbian. And she just threw her hands up and said, if that's what you want, then that's what you are. Whatever. But at this point, it was too late for Melinda in her life. She was already headed down a very dark and troubled road. She was breaking rules, skipping class, getting into trouble, getting into fights. Whatever direction she was going, with her mom's support or not, was not good. But I also wonder if her decision to become a lesbian was because she was abused by men. And when I say men, I mean her goddamn father. And then I think about how her mom stabbed her dad because she witnessed her dad being a creep. And I'm just thinking, how did you not protect your children? How do you have multiple daughters and every single one of your daughters got abused by the same man you chose to still have children with? Her mother should be ashamed of herself. She's bottom of the barrel. Trash. Trash. She ruined her daughter's life, essentially. All of them. Because all of them probably have issues. But she ruined Melinda's life. Because she knew what her husband was capable of and did nothing. How are you going to let your man sleep in the same bed as your adult, not adult, but teenage daughter? I'm going to jail for murder because I'm killing him. I mean, eventually, finally, she stabbed him, but she didn't stab him enough because he's still f***ing breathing and left you to then have a new family who probably doesn't know about his abuse and probably had more daughters. That I couldn't find online. I don't know if he had sons. I don't know if he had daughters. I just know he started a new family down in Florida with someone else, and it just infuriates me. Shonda's 12 years old. At 12 years old, she only ever had interest in boys. Now, I don't know if she had a boyfriend back in her own middle school, if she used to flirt with boys when she was cheerleading. I didn't research much on Shonda's previous love life. I mean, she's 12 years old. But at this point, she's never had romantic feelings for a female. She never expressed to her mother or to herself even romantic feelings or attraction towards other females. I don't even think sex was really on Shonda's radar. Amanda, who's 14, who has had this full-blown romantic sexual relationship with an older 16-year-old, knows that Shonda is innocent. She doesn't understand her feelings or her emotions, and Amanda kind of takes advantage of that, and she starts writing Shonda love notes. And as they're passing these love notes back and forth to each other, Shonda is growing romantic feelings for Amanda. In October, Amanda asked Shonda if she would be her date to the school dance. I remember when I was in middle school and being asked to the dance was a huge deal. But at the dance, if you went solo, when your crush or someone you liked asked you to slow dance, it was literally magical. Led Zeppelin, Stairway to Heaven came on, and you're like all standing there, and then your crush is like walking towards you and you're looking around the room and you're like, is he about to ask me to slow dance? It's a big deal. So Amanda asked Shonda to go to the dance. Obviously, Shonda says yes. So they go to the dance, and what should be a fairy tale evening quickly turns into a nightmare because Melinda, who has her eye on Amanda and Shonda, gets f***ing pissed. She's jealous as shit. So she goes up and she tries to fight Shonda, but Amanda breaks it up. This dance should have been fun, should have been exciting, should have taken Amanda and Shonda's relationship to the next level, but her jealous ex-girlfriend is in the building, stalking her, watching her, and coming in to pretty much end the relationship. Amanda intervenes and they don't end up fighting, but Shonda, for the first time, realizes, whoa, Melinda, Amanda's ex, is nuts. She's crazy. Do I really want to deal with this? But then again, we have to remember she's 12 years old. She doesn't have a clue. We don't understand red flags. We don't understand caution signs and warning tape and caution tape, whatever. We don't get that when we're 12. Our parents don't sit us down and say, hey, these are all the warning signs of people that you should stay far the away from, especially in relationships. My parents didn't sit me down and tell me that shit at 12. I'm sure your parents didn't sit you down and tell you that at 12. So again, a 12-year-old doesn't really know how to process correctly a woman, a jealous ex-lover, approaching her to fight her over what currently is new to her. It's just a mess. As time passed and weeks were passing, Amanda and Shonda were growing closer and Melinda was getting more and more and more jealous. At one point, Melinda wrote Shonda a letter telling her that she was jealous of their relationship and she wanted Shonda dead. On more than one occasion, Shonda and Melinda had altercations. They didn't become physical, but Melinda approached her and threatened her multiple times in public. At this point as well, Shonda's grades were terrible. She was failing almost all her classes. Amanda taught her how to forge her mom's signature on notices so that she wouldn't get in trouble. Her mother eventually found out and she completely freaked. Jackie was like, this girl is a terrible influence on you. Enough is enough. And she told Shonda she was banned from seeing Amanda. But like most kids, they found a way around it. Whether your parents tell you to do something or not, most kids find a way to do it. And Amanda and Shonda still were seeing each other, even though Jackie was like, I forbid this. I do not want this going down. She's a terrible, terrible influence on your life. Please stop seeing her. Please stop talking to her. And she still found a way to do it. So really, at the end of the day, Amanda is no better than Melinda at all. One day, Jackie goes out to the mailbox and she's checking the mail. And in the mailbox is a return letter that was sent back to Shonda's home address because of lack of postage. Shonda wrote Amanda a letter, and out of curiosity, like any mother, she opens the letter and she's reading the letter, and soon she realizes that her relationship with Amanda was sexual and romantic. Now she's thinking in her head, my daughter is 12 years old. This 14-year-old is taking advantage of my young daughter, and I'm pissed. I am pissed. I couldn't find online anywhere what these letters said or what she wrote to Amanda, but Jackie knew that a 12-year-old could not fully understand her thoughts and the sex that was in these notes. A 12-year-old could not properly process. So she felt that she was this way and she was becoming this way because of Amanda's influence. I think about when I was 12, and like I had crushes on boys. I think I started having crushes on boys in kindergarten. But at 12 years old, I wasn't really thinking about sex. I wasn't curious about sex. I don't think I was talking about sex at all. And I don't even think I had my period at 12. I think I got my period at 13. Maybe I got my period at 11, I'm not sure. But I lost my virginity at 14, which was a huge mistake. And even at that, when I think about losing my virginity at the age of 14, I think about how much I didn't have a f***ing clue about sex. I had no idea what I was doing. I didn't understand it. I didn't understand the emotions that go into doing it. I didn't have a clue. I was f***ing clueless. So at 12 years old, to be writing sexually explicit letters to your older girlfriend, I understand how her mom was like, there's no way that my 12-year-old daughter understands what she's even saying in these letters. There's no way she's comprehending what she is saying to this older 14-year-old girl. So I understand that completely, and I understand her frustration because I would be frustrated too. Jackie decided to transfer Shonda to a different school. She transferred Shonda to Old Lady of Perpetual Help Catholic school. Amanda was still writing Shonda letters, calling her at home, but at this point, Shonda was kind of distancing herself. She was spending more time with her classmates. at her new school, focusing on her schoolwork, because at her old middle school she was failing. So she was talking to Amanda less, which is exactly what her mother wanted. Before I get into the absolutely gnarly details of this kidnapping, torture, and murder, I want to tell you a little bit about the people that were involved in the kidnapping, the torture, and her ultimate untimely death. Melinda Lovelace was accompanied by three other females. The first female was Laura Tackett, who was 17 years old. Laura came from an abusive family as well. Child services would be in and out of that home, checking on the family regularly. Her mom was abusive, her dad was abusive. It was just a very toxic environment. Lori had an obsession with vampirism and paranormal activity, and by the age of 16, she began to self-harm. Lori was in and out of mental hospitals. Now, I couldn't find out if she was on medication. I couldn't find out what treatment she was on, but I did read online that Lori did in fact have borderline personality disorder. She was also a high school dropout, and despite living 50 miles away in Madison, Indiana, she became good friends with Melinda and was coming and driving to see Melinda despite being 50 miles away. She spent more time with Melinda than she did back at home with her clearly that family. The other girl was Hope Ripley, who was 15 years old. She also lived in Madison, Indiana, and was friends with Lori. Hope's parents did not like Lori, and they hated that she spent time with her, as any parent with eyeballs and a good judge of character wouldn't like Lori either. I don't like Lori, and I never even met the bitch. But Hope's parents did not like her and Lori being friends. Cue the last woman involved. Her name is Toni Lawrence, who was also 15 years old. Toni was childhood friends with Hope. Hope and Toni bonded over self-harming, and Toni would meet Lori and Melinda through Hope. On June 10th, 1992, Lori, Hope, and Toni hopped into Lori's car to head to a rock concert. Now, this is the first time Toni ever met Lori in person. And right from the beginning, Toni was like, the vibes are pretty off here. Unlike most girls in the 90s, Lori had a different exterior. She had harsh blonde hair, a boyish cut. She wore black from head to toe, including black lipstick. She had an overall unwelcoming exterior and didn't give off good vibes whatsoever. In the car, Lori looks at Hope and says, "Did you tell her yet?" And Hope's like, tell her what? And then Lori responds that we're gonna kill a girl tonight. Toni, witnessing all of this, is looking at Lori and Hope like this is some type of sick joke. She doesn't actually think they're being serious. Again, Toni's intuition about Lori not being a good person, a good vibe, is 110% correct. And she probably should have listened to that. Before the concert, Lori drove all the way to New Albany to pick up Melinda. This is the first time Toni would be meeting Melinda. I believe Hope met Melinda once or twice in passing, but barely knew anything about her. But this evening was the first night that Toni had met Melinda. Melinda, looking glamorous, casually hops into the car holding a large kitchen knife. She explains to the girls that she wanted to scare the shit out of this girl, Shonda, who had stolen her girlfriend, or was trying to steal her girlfriend, Amanda. At this very moment, Lori, Hope, and Toni all have never met Shonda before. They don't even know who she is. Lori drives to Shonda's house. Shonda, this weekend, is staying with her father, Steven, and his stepwife. Melinda hides in the car, and she tells him, go get Shonda in this vehicle. Toni, Hope, and Lori all get out of the car. They go, they knock on Shonda's door. She comes to the door. They're like, hey, Amanda wanted us to come get you. We're all gonna meet up, come with us, blah, 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 blah. Shonda has never seen or met any of these three females. But hey, they're knocking at my door and they say they know Amanda. So in her 12-year-old mind, she's thinking, well, I really wanna see Amanda. So she advises them to come back after midnight when her dad and her stepmom are asleep. So they're like, okay, cool. They get in the car, they head to the concert, and at the concert, Melinda is bragging and expressing her excitement about how she can't wait to kill Shonda. Then she'd cover it up with some ha-has and some LOLs and say that she was just kidding, she just wanted to scare. But Toni, in the very pit of her stomach, had a feeling that maybe, just maybe, this chick Melinda wasn't joking and she's being serious, and she had every plan to kill this young teenager tonight. So after the rock concert, they hop in the car and they head back to Shonda's dad's house. Shonda sneaks out, she heads to the car with these three girls she has never met before. In the car, Melinda's hiding. Lori starts getting Shauna just talk about Amanda. They're talking about Amanda, and they explain to her that Amanda is at the Witch's Castle, and they're all gonna meet up there. Now, the Witch's Castle is in Utica, Indiana, and it's an abandoned, creepy little spot that local teens would hang out to smoke or drink, whatever. Melinda jumps out of hiding, puts the knife to Shonda's throat. Shonda obviously screams, because who wouldn't scream when someone puts a knife to their throat, and jumps up from behind them. She's begging and she's pleading that she doesn't want to be hurt, to just bring her home. But Melinda says, "Shut up, bitch," and then proceeds to question her sexual relationship with Amanda. At some point, Shonda realizes, "I'm not seeing Amanda. Amanda is not where I'm about to be going." And like anyone would be, she is scared as shit to what the rest of the night entails. What are these girls? Where are they taking me? What do they have planned for me? She's scared. And she's also 12 years old. Now, I think about when I was 12, and I think about even if I wanted to sneak out, but I don't think I was trying to sneak out when I was 12, it would be nearly impossible for me to do so. And you don't want to blame the parents, but you have to think, how do you not hear a car pull up to your driveway? And at that, how do you not hear the front door open? And how do you not hear your 12-year-old daughter walking down your front steps into a vehicle? How do you not hear any of that? How? Luckily, we have all these security systems like ADT, so you don't tell your kid you have that. They try to sneak out, the alarm's going off, and everybody's waking up, and boop, guess what? You're not sneaking out anymore, kids. So I'm pretty sure they didn't have that back in the 90s, but even so, I just don't see how a 12-year-old could sneak out of their house without her dad or the stepmom hearing a goddamn thing. And even at that, when they showed up at the house earlier, and they banged on the door asking for Shonda, and Shonda goes to the door, as a parent, I'd be like, who the f*** are those three girls we have never seen before, ever? And how do they know where you live? Why aren't the parents asking questions? How do they not have control over their 12-year-olds? It's just really frustrating. I don't put blame on them, but it's just like, you could have done better. Could have protected her just a little bit more. Asked some more questions. When the girls all arrived at the Witch's Castle, Lori and Melinda tied Shonda up. Lori was taunting her, scaring her, saying that the place was haunted with dead people. And like any person who would be tied up with these psychopaths in front of them, Shonda's crying, pleading, begging to go home. Lori is entertained. She's enjoying every second of this. She takes a t-shirt that has a smiley face on it. She lights it on fire and tells Shonda that soon that would be her. Like a sick, twisted psychopath. They take Shonda, they get back in the car, and they leave the Witch's Castle. They're looking for an open gas station. Shonda suggests a gas station that's near her house. Lori is like, I see what you're doing there. She probably wants us to go to this gas station that's close to her house so she can run or scream or try to escape and get back home. Lori then covers her with a blanket when they get to the gas station so she's unnoticeable and she doesn't try to get help from anyone that could possibly be at the gas station. After they get gas, they drive around for a bit and then they end up in the woods somewhere near Lori's house. I believe they ended up at like some type of dump site or trash site that was down a remote path that they knew no cars would be driving down. They make Shonda strip naked and get out of the car. Melinda beat Shonda repeatedly with her fist, took her face and slammed it into her knee so many times that her mouth was bleeding from her own braces. At some point, Melinda tried to slit Shonda's throat, but the knife was too dull, so it didn't work. Hope got out of the car to hold Shonda down as Lori and Melinda took turns repeatedly stabbing her in the chest. Hope then gets back in the car, and Lori and Melinda wrap a rope around Shonda's neck until she passes out unconscious. They throw Shonda's limp body into the trunk of Lori's car, and they tell Hope and Tony that she is dead. And then they casually drive back to Lori's house so they can have some soda and clean themselves off. They get to Lori's house, they clean themselves off, they start drinking their soda, and then they realize that they can hear Shonda screaming from the trunk of the car. Lori grabs a knife, heads to the trunk of her car, stabs her repeatedly multiple times, and then comes back into the house covered in more blood. At around 2:30 a.m. in the morning, Lori and Melinda take Lori's car and they head to cruise around with Shonda still in it. Hope and Tony stay behind at Lori's house. I don't know how, either Hope or Tony, but most importantly Tony, because Hope has participated at this point. Tony is probably in disbelief. I understand being scared. I understand that it's a weird situation to be in, but how the do you have an opportunity to pick up a house phone and call 911 to tell them that this poor girl is being tortured. I'm at this address, they're in this car. Come help is beyond me. Or at least try to wake up Lori's parents. Because although she came from an abusive home, I'm sure Lori's parents aren't cool with their daughter torturing, stabbing, and planning on killing somebody. So how you don't pick up a house phone when you have an opportunity to call 911. Or wake up whoever is in this house with you to tell them, hey, this is what's going on, like, get help. It doesn't make any sense to me. Like, at all. You're 15 years old. At 15 years old, you know right from wrong. You know how to call 911. And you guys had an opportunity to do something and you did nothing. In fact, at the rock concert, when Melinda was bragging about how she can't wait to kill Shonda because she stole her girlfriend, you had plenty of opportunity to say, I'm gonna use the bathroom and get help. Tell someone, a security guard, use a phone, something. These girls up. Now, as Lori and Melinda are driving around, Shonda is still alive. She's crying, she's making gurgling noises because she's choking on her own blood. And Melinda and Lori are actually annoyed with her making gurgling noises, so Lori pulls over. Shonda sits up, eyes rolling to the back of her head, barely conscious, in pain, suffering. And Lori takes it upon herself to use a tire iron to beat her and sodomize her. At this point, Shonda is in so much pain, she can't even speak. And I'm not quite sure, it didn't say how long they drove around for, it didn't say how long they beat and sodomized her, but eventually they ended up back at Lori's house. When they got back to Lori's house, they brag about what they did to Shonda, to Hope and Tony. And again, they had an opportunity to call 911, and she's still alive. Mind you, she's would never be normal. She would never trust anyone again, and she would need years and years and years of therapy, but she was still alive. And they had an opportunity to, the cops could have been waiting for them when they got back, and they did nothing, nothing. At this point, it's almost dawn. The sun is almost coming up, and Lori's mother hears the girls talking, and she starts yelling at Lori about how she's out late, and why did she bring friends back home, etc, 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 and Lori's offers to bring them home. I don't know if this conversation was just yelling at each other from bedroom to bedroom, or Lori's mother actually approached them and saw everyone there. But if she did, in fact, approach them, how do you not notice remnants of blood? Why are you not questioning why young 15, 17 year old girls are up to the crack of dawn? It's bad parenting 101. Horrible parenting. The girls get back into Lori's car and they drive to another remote location. At this remote location, Lori and Melinda wanted to show off their torture skills to Hope and Tony. At this point, Tony has not participated. She refuses to look. She's paralyzed in fear. And honestly, Tony was probably petrified that they would turn around and kill her too. I don't know what I would do if I was in that situation. I mean, I would definitely be the type of bitch that's like, I'm getting help. But I also, if you're witnessing the people you're with have no problem torturing a 12-year-old, you have no idea what they would be content doing to you as well. So I don't know. I don't know. But Hope now decides to participate. Hope takes Windex and sprays the Windex into Shonda's eyes and says, "You're not so hot now, are you?" Keep in mind, Hope has never met Shonda before. Shonda is a complete and utter stranger to Hope, and she was completely content with torturing a complete stranger. Let that sink the in. Let that sink in. The girls then drive to a gas station near Madison Consolidated High School. They buy a Pepsi container and they buy some gas for the car. They drink a little bit of the Pepsi before dumping the rest and then filling the Pepsi container with gasoline. The girls then drive to Lemon Road, which is a country road surrounded by fields. Hope and Lori wrap Shonda in a blanket, who at this point is still alive. Can you imagine the strength and will to fight through all that torture, hours and hours and hours and hours of torture, and you still are fighting to be alive? She wasn't giving up. And at this point, even though she was suffering and in pain that I can't even imagine, she was still alive. They carry her to the edge of the field, which was still in view of the road, poured some of the container of gasoline all over her, and then lit her on fire. The girls get back into Lori's car and they drive away, but a few minutes later, Melinda is convinced that she's probably not dead, so they drive back to the field, take the rest of the gasoline from the container, dump it all over her, and set her on fire again. And when they know for sure she's dead, they get in Lori's car and they take off. At this point, a new day has started. The sun is up. It is January 11th, 1992. The girls went to McDonald's to have breakfast. It was reported that while they were having breakfast, they were laughing and making jokes at one point that the sausage they ordered looked like the corpse they just abandoned. At some point, Tony used a payphone to call a friend to let them know about the murder. At that point, Lori and Melinda realize it's time for Tony to go home. Lori drops off Hope and Tony, and then Melinda calls Amanda to let her know that Shonda was dead. Amanda did not believe her and agreed to meet up with Melinda later that day. Lori takes Melinda to pick up Amanda and they head back to Melinda's house. When they get back to Melinda's house, Melinda is hysterical, she's crying. She's giving Amanda full details of what they just did to Shonda. Again, Amanda refused to believe it. Until they took Amanda to Lori's trunk, and inside the trunk there was blood, bloody handprints, and one of Shonda's socks. Mortified, horrified, and probably being scared, Amanda demanded that she get taken home. I don't know how Amanda could ask two murderers to drop her home. That doesn't make any sense to me. If I witnessed this, I'd be like, I'm not getting in a car with you ever the f- again. I never want to see you ever the f- again. I don't know what I'm going to do, but I'm probably going to start running to a neighbor's house. That's what I would do. I would never be comfortable with those two psychopaths bringing me home. So that part of the story is very confusing to me. How do you ask to be brought home in the car your girlfriend was killed in? Not only killed in, but tortured in. How? Now, while these bitches were fine dying at McDonald's, brothers Don and Ralph Foley were about to go quail hunting. They made their way past Jefferson Proving Ground and they were driving about 8 miles up a country road. And as they're driving up this road, they notice a large black object on the side of the road. First, when they were driving closer to the object, they thought it was a blow-up doll. But as they got closer and closer, they realized that what they were seeing was the burned remains of a human being. That of a young woman. They turn their car around, they go home, they call 911. The sheriff advises them to get back in their car, drive back to the crime scene, and stay there until the sheriff arrives. I keep forgetting that in 1992, cell phones aren't like how they are now, so you can't just be in your car calling 911. They actually had to turn around, drive home, and call for help. So they did what they were told to do. They got back in their cars and they drove to where Shonda's burnt body was laying next to the road. Around 12 p.m. that afternoon, a deputy sheriff, a county sheriff, a detective, and a forensic expert all arrived on the scene. Everyone there was horrified. Horrified. Shonda's body was burned beyond recognition and she was also posed in a sexual manner. And the forensic expert that was on the scene had a feeling that she had been sodomized, which in fact she was. Meanwhile, back at Stephen Scherer's house, he wakes up and he notices that his daughter is not in her bedroom. He doesn't panic because he just assumes that she's downstairs in the family room, which is in the basement. He heads there and realizes she's not there either, so he starts to freak out. At first, he calls Shonda's friends, they know nothing. Then he calls his wife Jackie and he lets her know that Shonda is missing. She immediately rushes over and they file a missing persons report. Jackie, Steve, and his new wife Sharon all get in the car and they're looking everywhere for Shonda. They have no luck, they cannot find her. At around 8:30 p.m. that evening, Tony goes to the police station with her father and is hysterically crying and she cannot wait to tell the police everything. She cannot remember times. She can't remember what time they did this or what time they did that, but she remembers locations. And she, in fact, remembered Shonda's home address. So the police take that home address and they go to check to see if there was a missing persons filed. And there, in fact, was a missing persons report filed for 12-year-old Shonda Scherer. The description of Shonda in the missing persons report matched the description of the body they found at the crime scene. They used dental records to prove that it was, in fact, Shonda Scherer that they found that morning. On January 12, 1992, Lori, Melinda, and Hope were all arrested. They were all charged as adults but accepted plea deals to avoid the death penalty. Lori and Melinda were both sentenced to 60 years in Indiana's state women's prison. Now, I don't know how they only got 60 years for torturing and burning a 12-year-old to death. That to me sounds like in life, but they got 60 years. Again, I will never understand sentencing in any of the cases that I've done. None of the sentencing makes sense, but they got 60 years. Hope originally got 60 years, but then it got reduced to 35. And Toni, because she was cooperative and helped point the finger and everyone else involved, was sentenced to 20 years. She only got charged with one count of criminal confinement. Devastated, heartbroken, and probably overcome with guilt, Stephen Scherer, Shonda's dad, turned to alcohol to suppress his pain, and he died of alcohol abuse in 2005 at the age of 53. The death of his daughter, he could not overcome. He just could not move on, and I don't blame him. I would feel solely responsible that my daughter was at my house, snuck out, and on the night she snuck out was murdered. I would also, too, be overcome with guilt. During this trial, Belinda's past finally came to light, and her father, Larry Loveless, was arrested. In February of 1993, he was arrested and charged with rape, sodomy, and sexual battery. However, due to the statute of limitations, he only got charged with one count of sexual battery, which he pled guilty to. His sentencing was actually reduced to time served, and he was immediately released. Now, I don't know about y'all, but I see this all the time in shows and movies. Statute of limitations should not be a fucking rule. There's a lot of victims who don't have the courage to come forward, can't come forward, and when they do, it's too late. That doesn't make any sense to me. He's guilty of all of these and yet was able to walk free. He spent about 2 years in jail waiting for sentencing, and that was it, and then he's out. It's crazy. While Melinda was in jail, she started working with this program called ICANN, where she trained service dogs or trained dogs that were harder to deal with. Charlie Patrizzo, who was a burn victim who bred service dog, contacted Shonda's mother. She showed a video of Melinda doing this work and actually adopted a service animal, named it Angel, and donated it to the ICANN program to Melinda. I don't know about y'all, but I don't give a fuck about your past. I'm sorry that happened to you, but what happened to you gave you no fucking right on this planet to kidnap and torture my 12-year-old daughter for hours before burning her alive. So I don't give a fuck about how much rehabilitation you had. I don't give a fuck how many dogs you've trained. I don't give a fuck about you. You killed my daughter. You robbed her of a good life. You robbed her of a life, period. You took her from me. You took her from the world. I don't give a shit what you do now. I don't give a fuck that you can train dogs. There's plenty of people who are sexually abused that don't torture, kill, and set people on fire because of their pain. So I would have never donated a puppy for the murderer of my daughter to train. It's never happening. It's never happening. Now, I don't know if that gave Shonda mother some peace or closure or whatever, but I personally could never. I could never. In 2000, Toni was released from jail. In 2006, Hope was released from jail. In 2018, Lori was released from jail. And in 2019, Melinda was released from jail. I see Toni getting out of jail for sure, but Hope, Lori, and Melinda should be rotten in a f***ing jail cell until the f***ing day they take their last breath. I don't understand the legal system. I don't understand sentencing, but this shit don't make any sense to me. Of course, Toni deserves to go to jail because I personally feel like there was moments in time where you had an opportunity to save the day and you didn't do it. So yeah, you're going to jail. You're an accessory. You didn't participate, but you were there. Now Hope, Lori, and Melinda all participated. Hope help carry the body to the field where it was going to be burned alive. All of you should be rotting in a jail cell till the end of time. It makes no f***ing sense to me. This case, I feel, has no justice whatsoever. I'm baffled by it all. And it's kind of crazy that people get such, they get such little sentencing. Wait a f***ing second. Hold on a second. Melinda got out in 2000. She got sentenced in 1993 for 60 years. So 2019 minus 1993. She only went to jail for 26 f***ing years. 26 f***ing years for burning someone alive and torturing them for 12 hours. This is not justice. I need answers. You guys, everyone comment below their thoughts on this, because I didn't realize, but I'm like thinking, and I'm like, wait a second, 1993 to 2019, that doesn't seem like 60 years. And it was 26. So they only got 26 years in jail for brutally kidnapping torturing and killing someone, and they get to enjoy the rest of their lives free. Now, the court system used Melinda's past as an excuse for her behavior, but there is no excuse for your behavior. There is plenty of people that have been sexually assaulted or abused, tormented, and they have gotten help or turned their lives around. Not everyone deals with trauma and then puts trauma onto someone else. Lori used her rebellion against her family and their religious background as an excuse, but there's no excuse. She got out of jail early too. And then Hope and Tony, there's no other excuse because they didn't come from the same abusive background. So other than the trying to fit in with people they just met, they have no excuse for committing torture or murder either. So this whole case is actually appalling. But what's even more appalling of it is the fact that these people are all out of jail, enjoying life, able to watch TV, able to drink wine and soda and sparkling water, have burgers and french fries, take dogs for walks, try to get jobs after torturing a 12-year-old and burning her to death. I'm sick. This story makes me sick. I want to hear your thoughts below. I want to hear your thoughts on the sentencing. I want to conversate with y'all about this because I'm so deeply disturbed by this. It's really just like... Anyways, that is this true crime and wine. I hope you guys enjoyed it. Give this video a thumbs up or a thumbs down. But as I always say, if you're giving it a thumbs down, you probably shouldn't be on this channel. But if you are gonna be here, make sure you hit that subscribe button, but also hit the bell, because if you don't hit the bell, you will not get notifications. And if you don't get notifications, what is the point? There is none. Most importantly, hit the link in the description box for subscribing to our Wave channel for more exclusive content, vlogs, story times, mukbangs, you name it. My social media is in the description box below. And when you do these true crimes and I retell them, it's just a really scary thought that you don't know the people that your exes have dated and their mental state. You also don't know the mental state of people around you, because really at the end of the day, Tony and Hope didn't know Shonda and they didn't really know Melinda, and yet here they are helping her commit one of the nastiest crimes I've ever read about, and then getting out of jail early. And then you wonder why people are like, well, I'm gonna kill someone too because I'm gonna get out of jail early just like these girls. How is any of this justice? Leaves me very unsettled. So I'm just gonna go ahead and end this video because I don't even know what else to say. I don't.